representing the act of writing itself by rewriting what I've written before, even in this very notebook. But I'm also not representing it. I'm living it. Unlike Susie, my body as an art object, a writing machine, does not refer to anything except its own self. My embodied conditions can make the act of writing a test of endurance. At times, it may feel like an automatic act, but at others, it is an intentional act of bodily self-discipline. My body and the writing materials it engages with meet different degrees of friction and resistance in the making of the mark, amplified by the codes of social order. As the Susie's effectively broken neck, my own sore shoulders and aching hands reflect the separation of spirit and mind from the material body. As I inscribe on the page, I'm also being inscribed upon by the forces of conformity, prescribed by a culture that depends on standardization. The performance of putting pen to paper embodies this tension between my own personal subjectivity, the objectifying world of social relations, and the academic institution as a form of social control. My body has been subjected over and over to the routine mechanizations that come with Enlightenment ideals. Sitting in a row, writing in rows, making sure I fit into a rational order within the hegemonic mechanisms of knowledge creation. My repetitive actions, do they lead to repetitive thoughts? Can my thoughts get a repetitive strain injury too? Just as an awareness of my lived subjectivity in the present moment may add tension to this performance, it is the felt presence of the body in writing that lends it the power to possess meaning and to matter. Both the performed body and writing are suspended somewhere between activity and object, while an awareness of a performer's consciousness and the labor ostensibly involved in handwriting still implicate an embodied and unworlded subject. Mark-making is the way the lived body expresses its phenomenological self. However regulated, it cannot avoid inscribing its singular intentionality in acts and marks of expressive improvisation. The material lived body making its meaningful mark on the world is a necessary condition of its very existence. It is through this embodied modality that writing conveys meaning to the world.
Right. So, as you know, I speak and I try to keep up with this, the tensions between kind of the ways that we've been taught to write and the ways that like my actual hand flows through the page kind of, I feel like it's an embodiment of that tension of the ways that we're taught to write and how we're taught to, and how we really experience it. And for my own practice, I hope to not just write, and I think that language and the written word and everything will always be part of my creative practice because it's formed so much of how I think of the world and how I constitute it. But I also want this to serve as an example of how to interrogate a specific materiality, to kind of break down writing, break it down, and then apply that kind of same technique to other forms of materiality. Because in taking agency over something, you the lived body in its socially constructed state, the body has meaning in the gestures it makes, in the way that it moves, and in that sense, it also has meaning in the way it interacts with something. For example, if I, a hammer is a hammer. Bear with me. a hammer is a hammer, either by the way that it has a handle and a top, and it the shape of a hammer, or a hammer can be a hammer because I have picked up this rock and I'm using it to hammer something. So that's kind of where I'm coming from and the technique I want to apply to my practice moving forward. Any questions? Comments? Concerns?
Yeah. Definitely. I think that's when I was reading the reading. And as a person who writes and enjoys writing more physically than I do on a computer, there's definitely a relationship that you have with not just the fact that you're writing on paper, but what you use as well. I had a conversation with a friend of mine who also writes frequently, and he only ever writes with super expensive ink pen, because it just feels different. It flows better. Even that pen that you're using, it almost looks like a paintbrush.
I ordered 3 of these from Japan because I had one last year and really, really liked it, and didn't want to not have this specific pen to write. It's such a personal thing.
And I really like enjoy that you presented that kind of, like, you were in the intimate space, but projecting that intimacy onto the screen to allow us in. But even then, we weren't in that process of like the words that you chose. Like, we heard the audio, but we were reading your own interpretation of your own audio, of your own interpretation of your writing while you're writing your interpretation, which is really meta, really awesome, and it's really, really great.
So, yeah, hearing it totally, and it is like such a like private thing, and I really enjoy writing, and I also really wanted to like show kind of. It's funny because it's like this tension of like it kind of shows how it looks through my eyes, and like I love seeing like the way that a pen spreads over a page, but at the same time this is like so not my eyes, and there's this like huge disconnect where like I cannot really fully show this like immersion that I feel.
Mm-hmm. I think you're gonna love hate watching this video. You talk with your hands so much, and like at the end, like when you really got into it, like your hands waving behind you, like as you're expressing it, it's just like. Almost like puppeting over you.
it was just I can't wait for the hate part of that. Yeah.
You were recording the video, I totally photobombed that.
Sorry.
It's okay.
I was just saying, seeing how you put up the page with writing, it's kind of like reading, seeing an artist kind of fill up the canvas. Like, I always like, I always pay attention when I take notes of like how I occupy the space, because like I either write too big.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, like the inverse side of that is like you can see kind of like the process of somebody, whether they do take the time process, or there's sometimes like if I look at my notes, there's times when I sat down and tried to be present, and other times when I'm just writing. And if I'm ever writing on stream of consciousness, like I never start at the margin, you know, like it's in the middle of the page, or like sometimes it's sideways, I'll draw arrows, and like, you know, and in this that kind of like experience of writing that's like the stream of consciousness that's like less precise that you have access to when you're writing sitting down versus on the computer, like you always have to start like at the beginning unless you want to do like tap 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 or like, you know what I mean, you're not gonna, that's actually a conscious decision to go tap tap tap, you know.
Yeah, it's a really funny tension because on the computer, like on one hand you're like, oh, it's so non-linear, you know, like you're like, I can always go back, I can always edit what's before, but it's still like structured in that way.
Mm-hmm.
And like it's, and it kind of like erases the editing, and I feel like the dialogue of that is like a really interesting part of it.
It erases the process, right?
Yeah.
That's
my,
the thing.
My friend actually has a poetry series called Track Changes, where she like writes a poem and then like erases parts of it.
Nice.
With track changes. So and then the like erase part becomes the actual poem, but she publishes both in tandem.
Wonderful.
Writing on paper, like I have actual space, and I have total freedom of like writing things smaller because I just had a tiny thought that I want to put like somewhere in margin, and adding like tons of weird arrows that connect thoughts. That makes sense to me. When I'm like in a word processor, I always want to do those things, and like I feel like a similar difference of timing to like when you have a ton of thoughts that you were trying to like make sense of in a sentence, they go way too fast in your head for you to like catch every detail and write them down. So you only manage to like get a bit of the thought that you had every time until you like have managed to map it all out spatially.
Yeah, like, and it kind of is told in the fragments in a way, and like your thoughts are so non-linear too. And I also did make the like the part that I read up like recorded, I intentionally made it like really like wordy and dense and complicated to like kind of like aggravate that tension even more. Yeah. And there's also this like interesting thing of like the boundedness of the like writing on a computer where like you have so many pages and so many pages, and I like in doing the reading I never even thought about how like it almost like wants you to fill it. and there's no like end, and just like that like hit of like I can write forever is so daunting. And like whereas like when you're writing on a page, like it's the boundedness is actually kind of like a freedom in a way, where like there are boundaries on the page, but that like because then you have physical boundaries, it feels like the boundaries of like what you're thinking is almost freed up.
Like either you have a super long highway that goes on forever, or you have like a very large field where you can go any direction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, for sure, exactly. I'd rather run around in a field.
Yeah, like drive forever.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
I actually really appreciated Sobchak's kind of going back to childhood and all of it, like
mm-hmm.
using a toy as starting with a toy and kind of bringing it down as a cultural object, and also talking about like our relationship, like with her interview with a 5-year-old, 6-year-old, and our relationship to writing, and going back to like the moments when we learn how to write. And when I read the chapter, I was like, that's why I like. I like the cheap plastic beak, like blue beaks, very basic ones. Because I think they remind me of that like friction that happens on like the finger when you hold it for too long, and because like they engrave, like
it is really like a thing that marks.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Like it doesn't flow. It's like it's more like there you go.
It's
the best.
I'm thinking of a different one. Probably a more cheaper version. Lays with like all blue, leaves all the same color.
Yeah,
yeah. The ones
that
are breaking up
like,
in your head the minute you start writing.
Can I say one last thought?
Yeah.
Just that, like when I was little, my mom literally bought like this like rubber thingy to put on my pencil that would like put my fingers in the right place.
Yeah.
And like my fingers just wouldn't do it. Like like it just didn't feel right. And like it's crazy how just like these like things are so taught in such like a playful way with like like a little accessory for your pencil, but really it's like indoctrinating you.
Yeah, it just reminded me of like a very long conversation I had maybe when I was like 5 or 6 with a friend. It just reminded me of that conversation of like, how do you hold the pen? Is it this way or this way? And we'd have like, is it 3 fingers or 2 fingers?
Totally.
I know, it's like a conversation.
It's like political.
It's a political choice.
I don't know, maybe you need to learn how to write again.
Oh, thank you.
I didn't even show her.
So it's your big body.
Yeah,